Satsuki looking for that damage, finds him on the Diablo. Diablo forced it back out as their health drops low. The Immortal now is at 20.
Back down, Yo, on the Greyman, give me the first ball. But is it ETC? No, that's Malthale up there. A triple.
The Leyline used in the back, catching three people on top. That followed up by the APOC and the Lurking Hunt. Catching two, but this time on, it's going to be the first.
Wow, did you see that mosh pit? Four-man mosh pit, while on a conveyor belt. That was like a regular sushi.
There's the lead, catches him in the mud pit. Time trap does pop. Mosh pit goes out. Ruby's still in trouble. Pops to stay a while to listen, but it's not going to matter.
Here comes the Bonobos on the backside. The Bonobos get plundered and then stunned. Oh my goodness! The Bonobos!
Getting shrunk down, ETC getting killed. He becomes dog food for the Greyman.
I didn't think they had a chance. I thought it was all over. We said all or nothing, and they got absolutely everything.
Well, Jay, we are here at this 8 o'clock game for an A-West matchup between Boosted Bonobos and Nature's Cure, and I'm going to throw out my disclosure. I completely revamped my casting overlay, so there will probably be some snafus. In fact, there was already one. The prolonged period of silence was because a sound setting wasn't done properly, but it is fixed now, and we are here ready to go.
Well, you know, it can be a little awkward, but at the end of the day, we're really only here for one thing, Mongoose, and it's to watch these two NGS teams go head-to-head here out of the A-West. A couple of, Mother Nature's greatest team names here in Nature's Cure and Boosted Bonobos. I had to look up what a bonobo was when I saw I was casting this match, but no, of course, it's a chimpanzee.
So we'll check in with the... All right, well, ladies and jelly spoons, we found out that we don't have sound in the standings screen as well. So you did see the standing up there. 8-bit asking who has the better logo, Jason, Bonobos or Jason? And of course, the answer is Jason because it's carbon. You can't compete with carbon.
That's but very fair.
We are in draft, Mr. Jason. Here on Alterac Pass.
Yeah, probably the biggest map in the format right now. Definitely top to bottom is very hard rotational map. So you see a lot of quick rotation heroes, a lot of globals utilized here. The ability to push lanes to counter soak can be a strong thing to utilize here while you're waiting to go to these objectives, because the timing on these objectives, of course, is not incredibly important. You can afford to give up a little bit of it, and the camp, of course, mid camp is huge. So right away we see big camp damage out with Rexxar going away, Sylvanas going away, and then the good poke damage coming in from Chromie going to be banned out.
And not just time? Vikings, but first pick lock by Lost Vikings, and this kind of leads me to my thing. Both of these teams play a lot of Vikings. I think that explains the uber high priority on that hero.
For sure.
I believe, if I'm not mistaken, Boosted Bonobos has played it twice so far this season. Enigma plays a really good
the light abandons
Vikings.
No man.
And now coming out on the other side with the Flex Uther, could be tank, could be second support, could be main support, and wipeout on the Sonya.
Yeah, that's why he's so good early. He doesn't really give anything away. And the Sonya is very, very strong in the meta right now, and a good counter to the Lost Vikings. You know, one of the things that sometimes the Vikings will try to do to counter a solo laner is pile those Vikings into one lane to push against them. But Sonya's ability to spin on them kind of gives her a little bit of a defense against that.
Yeah, not just that. She has the damage output to kill one of them if she catches the Vikings player not on that particular part of the map to macro them. She pushes hard enough to do structure damage, right? The Vikings can't prevent her from doing structure damage if she gets onto structures. So all good things there. The flip side of it, we have a Zul'jin and a Johanna, and then an Anduin ban coming out for the boosted Bonobos.
Yeah, they've got their Uther already. So they can afford to get rid of one healer to kind of chokehold here. And if they still want to pick up another healer, they have the next heal pick. So they can really put quite the squeeze on Nature's Cure's option. I don't know, maybe just by the name, maybe Malfurion?
Or Lunara, yeah.
There you go.
And the Zeratul, the traditional Viking hunter, who I think has fallen out of favor a little bit in that role, but Zeratul looked at by some as a little bit of a Viking's counter to able to run down and kill those Vikings and alone in lane.
Yeah, he's pretty good on this map as well.
Yep. Fused, going to be playing the Phoenix, and there's your double support. So this points to a tank Uther pick, I think, is likely is what this is going to be.
Yeah, I really like the Lucio pickup. It allows for a little bit of quick rotational synergy, which you kind of need against the Vikings. You need, because the Vikings can spread out into those three different lanes here, and the four-man can kind of roam and gank. So the ability to speed up your own rotations to kind of answer to that a little bit can help against the strat.
Yeah, so Nature's Cure rounding out with a very strong four-man. You've got the tank, the support, auto-attacker, mage. So that group will pretty much just stay together, maneuver around the map, pressure lanes, try to get kills, while Vikings handle all of the unsung hard work of soaking, and will probably not get much camera time because, well, that's not what they do. And then Kerrigan, so very aggressive comp from the boosted Bonobos with the Kerrigan there. They're really going to need to secure kills in the 4v4, I think, to offset the Vikings here a little bit.
Yeah, one of the biggest weaknesses against a Vikings comp is if you don't have the ability to engage. If the other team can just walk away with their four-man and allow the Vikings to continue to soak, you can get value and then run away whenever the team comes to answer to you. So the ability to maybe Sonya Leap, maybe Uther and Divine Storm, but the Kerrigan as that last pick gives you immense engage potential.
All right, well, in just a few seconds after this quick intro, we'll jump. All right, Jay, once again, we are back in game one. I did add sound so people can hear us. Otherwise, it just would have been a lot of nothing. But in the blue trunks, the boosted Bonobos, featuring Wipeout on Sonya, Patience on Lucio, Muffin will be playing Uther, Confused on Phoenix, and InfoFox on Kerrigan.
And over for the side of Nature's Cure, we've got Soil Water on the Zul'jin. The J Ruckus is going to be on the Johanna. Enigma on all three of the Lost Vikings. Noel Sanaka going to be on the Orphea. And Heroes Polyphics is going to be on the Sukhov.
And you see bottom lane, little Eric is threatening the well down there. He can kind of get to a spot where he can attack it if you leave him be. But Wipeout here to prevent that. And the clash mid lane. Things happen. To the Sonya, Silence goes out and really breaks up that engagement, forcing Boost of Bonobos back.
Yeah, Sukhov's going to be a pretty essential hero in this comp as well, just for his ability to disengage. If he can get a good swipe or a particularly effective shove, after post 10. He can stop those engages right in its tracks.
Oh, that's a rough luck for boosted bonobos. They set up for an ambush, but Nature's Curse rotated completely in the other direction. kind of breaking up the bush party there. Yeah, the Kerrigan into the Stukov, I think, is going to be a little rough, to be honest.
Yeah, it'll depend on exactly how well Hero Prolifics can actually position those lurking arms. And the timing is going to be important there, but we'll have to see how well boosted bonobos are able to get onto their opponent. And based on the idea of their name and their logo, you'd think they could fly in there and do a pretty good job.
Yeah, I'd love to see a jetpack here. But man, Nature's Cure is doing work in the bottom lane. We're a minute 50 in the game, and the front wall is gone in its entirety. But here goes Muffin on the big flank. He's going to land the hammer onto the Stukov. Follow-up is there, but Johanna does a real nice job of breaking it up. Kerrigan on the secondary engage. Stukov in a lot of trouble. First blood over to boosted bonobos. Real nice flank, aggressive positioning by Muffin, and great patience on the InfoFox, kind of waiting out the CC before finally going in.
Yeah, but you got a question a little bit here, Mongoose. Was that worth it for the one pick? If you get multiple picks, maybe, but you look at the XP bars here, and Nature's Cure actually has the lead despite that first blood pick.
Well, that Sonya kill was rough. Now, I like what Boosted Bonobos did. They got the kill rotated mid and got the entire wall mid, and that's kind of evened out the XP if you look at it. But Confused and Patience may be caught out, boosting away. So, actually, with the kill and the structure and the camp, Boosted Bonobos about a half a level down now. Not too bad, but we do have a pause from Noel Sanaka on Nature's Cure. The fire alarm apparently going out. The match.
I guess everybody hears the fire alarm, right?
The match is so hype that it set off the fire alarm.
This match is, well, I'm not going to finish that because of DMCA, but you get the joke.
Yep. So, I mean, that's a good point, right? Early game death timers are so low, short, that the kill is kind of irrelevant. Now, they did leverage into siege damage mid. But I think they kind of have to have that mentality of we have to kill heroes, because as the game goes on, the death timers get longer. Those kills mean more and more. You know, if that kill happened, you know, in 10 minutes from now, it's a totally different thing. So I kind of like the mentality of we need to get in there. We need to kill some of these guys.
Right. And well, traditionally, the first 10 levels are the most effective levels for a Kerrigan comp. So boosted bonobos, if they don't get some sort of advantage here in these first 10 levels, I kind of fear for their ability with how well Nature's Cure's comp is going to scale, particularly with that Zul'jin, for them to be able to really put up a fight in the back half here.
Yeah, I think what's really going to determine how this game goes is we really want to watch the team fights, right? There's no way that boosted bonobos are going to keep up with the map presence of the Viking. It's just not possible for them to do that, right? So that means they have to win team fights. It's just an absolute necessity. If they're winning or splitting, if they're losing or splitting team fights, they're not likely to win the game. They need to be winning team fights to offset the map positioning disadvantage that Vikings puts them in.
Right. Yeah, not only that, but the boosted bonobos have to be careful about taking long engages, right? Like, correct. You want to get in there, get your cooldowns down, get a kill or two, and then take advantage. And we saw them do that there. But if they stick in too long, then they're getting stacks to Zul'jin, which they don't want to do. So really great job in the early game here. We'll see if they can continue to execute on that to, you know, use Lucio's mobility, get in there, get the quick team fight win, back on out, and go back to taking care of the map and the objective.
All right, here we go. Both teams are ready. We will be jumping back into the game.
All right, lads and lassies, keep our prison camp from being captured.
So boosted bonobos were scattered around the map trying to maximize the XP. Enigma pulled the Vikings back until they show again. Now you notice that bottom lane Viking on the minimap. As soon as boosted bonobos shows, he runs out into lane. Boosted bonobos is already on the objective. We have successfully channeled. And here we go.
Right away, the stun in for Muffin onto Noel Snake. J-Ruck is trying to keep close to that Kerrigan, trying to make sure they can't jump onto the squishy backliner here. Doing a nice job of zoning. There goes the blind to kind of disrupt some of the capping. They do have 13 seconds left on the objective. Infobox getting super low, gets taken out there by that Orphea. And now it looks like it's going to be boosted Bonobos on the run here as the camp is secured. About 8 seconds left still on that to be able to cap it later if they want here.
So Sonya will rotate mid, will do her best to clear this out. Once again, death timers go super, super low, and boosted Bonobos will be available to contest this should they choose to. Phoenix doing her best, confused, to soak out top lane. 18 seconds left on objective. They're rapidly running out of time, but now they're counting. Here comes Kerrigan, here comes everybody. There goes the stun. Unstoppable with pop. Objective still going, though.
Yeah, Nygma trying to stay towards the back there with that Olaf, kind of being a pest on the backside. Eric falls, though, on the other side of the map. Meanwhile, Olaf does get taken down, and the camp is secured here for the Horde, but it's going to be at the cost of Orphea and maybe more as Kerrigan goes in. Are they going to be able to get the kill on Infobox? No.
I think
and then there's
get Joe here.
In.
Yeah, Iron Skin was down, so Nature's Cure really hard committed to making sure they got that objective. They hung in there longer than I think they would have if the objective wasn't like 5 seconds away, right?
Right.
They paid for it with some kills, but probably worth it at this point in the game to get the early map pressure with the Vikings.
Yeah, and they're gonna be able to soak up every lane because of these Vikings to at least get some advantage out of the map objective. But the question here is how much can they really push? Once you get a set of these going down each lane, you'd like to get some siege damage in, but it's definitely getting them closer to 10. They're winning the race there right now.
Look at the bush party right here. Will Nature's Cure catch somebody? It's going to be Lucio in first, and nope, they're going to catch Uther. There it is. Uther puts the stun on the Orphea, but he is in trouble. Olaf goes down somewhere else on the map, but a nice little aggressive bush party by Nature's Cure waiting patiently. They let the Lucio go by to pick up a kill on a much less mobile Uther.
Yeah, Olaf went kind of up and into the fort area, and I'm not really sure what that was, but, you know, you're controlling three characters, Goose. You expect to maybe lose track of one every now and then.
For sure, and this is something we saw Nature's Cure do in the bottom. When there's nobody here to defend, we just shove in as a four-man, and there's really not a lot boosted Bonobos can do about it. Top fort maybe goes down, although it looks like they're coming.
I mean, when you think about it, Goose, I usually only have to control one character, and I still lose track of it sometimes. But level 10s are coming in for Nature's Cure. It is, it's going to be that Blessed Shield, along with the Play Again, Crushing Jaws, Flailing Swipe, and Clouds in the pick. But here comes the big combo here, the Leap and the Divine Storm thrown down, but a big swipe coming in off the backside. Not going to be enough to save Zul'jin. And Joe's going to go down once again. So another two picks as once again, boosted Bonobo is able to get on top and get the engage they wanted here.
Yeah, that was a really nicely done by boosted Bonobos there. And that's kind of what we were saying early, right? They need to get kills to do that, and a real nice job of Muffin of setting up with the Deep Storm and then the Leap
more
to follow up,
have been
getting
prisoner.
A couple kills and evening out the levels once again.
Right. Yeah, 6-3 on the kill count, but yeah, the levels are pretty close still because of the Viking soak here, but I'm pretty happy with where they're at right now. They're keeping in this game into the late game, but we'll have to see ultimately how it goes here. I think the next couple of fights are really going to swing the momentum.
Well, yeah, if they maintain a 2-1 kill differential here, those death times will be much longer later in the game, so
right.
That will mean more. So we'll see if they can maintain that. Both teams seem to be coming down here, up and taking a lot of damage. Everybody but the Vikings are here. There goes Crushing Jaws. It does catch two, but they do walk the other direction. Lurking Arm will zone boosted Bonobos away, and now it looks like they're back for more. Going on to Zul'jin. Leaf does not catch anybody, but Wipeout is really pressuring Azuljin, Kerrigan, and Uther both go down on the other side. Play It Again is used. Boosted Bonobos forced to retreat.
This is the moment that Nature's Cure was waiting for. You know, if you keep that 2-to-1 kill count, sure, that's great. But that's all that was really keeping Boosted Bonobos even on XP and still kind of in this game. So it just took one good team fight for Nature's Cure. And now they've still got Vikings soaking every lane. They've got the map objective. They've, they're getting that XP lead going. Can't grab on the other side, so I like that, of course, macro play. You kind of expect to see up here in A West, but Nature's Cure needs to do that maybe once or twice more, and I think they might be able to start pulling away.
Yeah, unfortunately, not enough time combined with the talent tier disadvantage for Boosted Bonobos to contest, so they seem content to pick up the camp, soak the other lane, and now teams kind of flirting with each other. Ironskin is popped.
Yeah.
And now they go on Orphea. To Orphea, but a great crush in Jaju towards a disengage, and a great Divine Storm will lead to Orphea going down. Joe running for her life. Lucio says, nope. And down goes Stukov. An unanswered triple kill once again on the back of the objective. Boosted Bonobos getting aggressive and picking up some kills.
I was about to come out with the phrase, they got the map objective and this time didn't have to pay for it with kills. So I think that might have been my fault. Not for saying it, Goose, but just for thinking.
You put the thinking cast first.
Right. And so now they're pushing in. They're pushing in as much as they can here, getting the soak with the Vikings a little bit here in bot. Not so much in the top lane where it's an easy kill. So that's exactly what Boosted Bonobos needed in that moment. They're going to lose this bottom fort, but that's not really that much for that second map objective.
No, absolutely not. Double objective, and you're only down one fort. It's really not a bad place to be. 14-14. Boosted Bonobos actually up in levels a little bit. Not a lot, but a little. Nature's Cure will rotate onto their camp, and I think we're going to see a Viking go down, and then either map pressure or boss, and it looks like it is a boss call, Mr. Jason, for the boosted Bonobos.
Poor Eric, the not swift enough there, but,
And Nature's Cure, they're going to make the mirror move. They know where Bonobos is, that top fort is already weak. They figure, you know what, we'll just take the trade up a little bit in structures. It's actually pretty close. Bottom boss secured first, before the Bonobos top boss shortly after. But the Bonobos are rotating up here. They're way out in front leading the charge. But unfortunately, they will not arrive in time. And now we will go back to housekeeping for both squads. They do go on to Baylog, and Baylog eats the Hammer of Justice from Uther this time. Mid lane, though, Infobox is in trouble. Caught on the rotation. Nature's Cure now going to pressure the mid fort.
Yeah, Nature's Cure taking a page out of Booster Bonobo's book there as they catch Kerrigan in the rotation. But here comes the Divine Storm. They're going to try to push them back a little bit here to protect their fort. And really, if you're Nature's Cure, you're not looking to give them a lot of team fights here. You want to get Zul'jin stacked, but with the pick potential that they have, you don't want to be too overly aggressive. We'll see the swipe, and now they're going to try to walk away, but if they pursue, they have the speed to do so, but for now it looks like they're just going to drop back and grab the camp.
And you notice both teams didn't fully finish off the boss. They brought him down to like 25% health and then kind of left him.
Yep.
That's something both sides did, actually. So structures, a little bit of an advantage here for Nature's Cure. They have one full fort as opposed to a fort that just needs a sandwich thrown at it to go down. Both sides do secure the mid lane bruisers. Both sides at level 17. This is a big one here, I think, Jason.
We'll see the stun come out right away. But look at the crushing jaw from the other side, isolating them in. Derek the first to fall, but a huge Sabo coming out from Confused on the flank from the bottom. I'm going to turn this fight all the way around, Mongoose. So that's going to be two-thirds exchange for zero?
Yeah, absolutely. And that is what Boosted Bonobos needs to do, right? They have to clean up in those team fights. And that allows the rest of the team to break up, go deal with the Viking pressure while the respawn timers are ticking down for Nature's Cure. Oh, they may have caught Zul'jin.
No.
Great play by Muffin and InfoFox and Confused. And now the first time it looks like, and almost assuredly, the first objective of this game for boosted Bonobos.
Yeah, so now we'll see what they can do with it. The Vikings, good at soaking, not great at anti-siege. So it's a good opportunity here for the Bonobos to actually get some pretty good siege damage in. Their comp has decent siege damage with the Kerrigan and, I should say the Sonya and the Phoenix. But they're going to catch Enigma out here up top again. We kind of expect that to happen occasionally, but the Viking kills are starting to rack up.
Yeah, and having said that, though, Eric is getting a lot of free reign bottom. I assume at some point they're going to send somebody down there, or maybe not. Maybe they just figure he cannot deal with the cavalry right now. We don't have to worry about it. And yeah, we're going to five stack somewhere. Maybe that's the route they're going to take. Yeah, they kind of went around, didn't show, and now they're back to push top lane, which is the most vulnerable lane for Nature's Cure here. Oh, Crystalis juking
nice.
The crushing jaws. Great play by InfoFox. Big lurking arm breaks up the party. And now that's a long cooldown for Duke.
Yeah, they are pressing into the top key, the key front wall here. Gonna fall and about 50% left on the cavalry here. Time Swarm gonna go down. Lucio trying to help speed everybody out. Reposition here. I mean, we think about doing something else. Level 20s. So close here for the Bonobos. They do not want to throw into this keep area.
Yeah, if that series of CC had gone on to anybody that wasn't named Johanna, they would be dead. But speaking of Johanna, gets the Blessed Shield out. Down goes Kerrigan. Full retreat for boosted Bonobos. But luckily, they've got rollerblades. And they're getting out pretty quickly.
Yeah, that's a big pick, though, for Nature's Cure. Is that moment where you want to force before 20... because the enemy team is close to beating you there, but that big Blessed Shield coming out there, and they're able to get that engage with the Juruckus? I like it, the J-Ruckus, because, well, you know.
Sure. So, will they get Olaf here? Probably.
Probably. I mean, with Lucio, they can chase him forever, but the question is it worth it?
No, it is not. Is
no, 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 not worth it.
So,
especially when down bot, we got boss.
And they've sniffed it out.
On.
They're on their way down here hard, too, but no Kerrigan. So this will be like a 4v3 and a third, or 4v4 and a third. Boosted Bonobos a little late. Play it again. He's down here. All the Vikings are here now, Jay. And boosted Bonobos want no part of that. They are backing up.
Yeah, I think that was a call of, hey, they're actually here. Maybe we could take this fight. And so the Vikings come down, but now they're going to start poking at each other. Big Divine Storm coming in once again. And in the cage, Sonya locking everybody in. And we're going to see a couple deaths on both sides. Well, only one Viking going down here for Nature's Cure. Eric goes down as well, but still, that's a big win here for Nature's Cure. They get the two for two Vikings.
Yeah, Hero Splifix, is that what we're saying? I'm going to say that Hero Splifix had an absolutely money lurking arm right in the middle of that engagement, and it really stopped the momentum of boosted Bonobo's cold and led to a double counter kill on both of the supports. And I don't think they're going to be up in time to contest. 36 on the objective, 28 on the death timer. That's real dicey.
Yeah, and it's been kind of a seesaw a little bit for momentum, but the issue with that seesaw is that that's going to favor the Vikings team, because they've always got the Vikings to spread out, to soak, and, boosted Bonobos need to win a lot more often to keep up here. And so now this is the pendulum swing back in Nature's Cure favor. They're looking for keeps here with this push. And this time, Mongoose, I get the feeling like there's a good chance that they're going to get away without having to give up any kills.
Maybe.
I'm hoping I didn't just jinx them.
Bonobos want something there running. They don't want Olaf, though. Olaf's like, take me. They're like, nah.
when the blue team won't even gank you.
No, I will say, though, this map isn't like a lot of maps where, you know, you can win a team fight, break through to keep it, and there's the leap with the cage, Divine Storm. Stukov is stuck in there with Sonya, and he goes down. Kerrigan goes down as well. Wipeout in trouble, as is Joe, but she is the first to go down. Bodies hitting the floor all over the place, but the Katas, the cavalry, I should say, is pushing in the meantime. Boosted Bonobos with the win.
Wow.
Taking out 4 2/3 of the team of Nature's Cure, and now they need to rush back. Enigma, look, he's going to stop the Hearths.
Oh,
great play.
Eric the... Oh, man, really? Coming in hard there. Going to stop them back. And that is a fight that I just... I don't know if Nature's Cure needed to take that fight at all, but they're still going to get some pretty good advantage out of keeping them busy.
I mean, look at this core, Jay. It's taking a lot of damage.
Yeah, I mean, the core does heal itself, so as long as they don't get the win here, which they will successfully defend it, that core is going to come back. They get 2 keeps, but my question, Mongoose, is if they don't take that fight, what do they get with the ability to push with these objectives? Do they win the game off of being alive?
Maybe. I think it would have been hard for them to get much more than 2 keeps without securing kills anyway. I you know, the way that went down, it was just a lose-lose for Boosted Bonobos. They got the kills but lost 2 keeps, and Nature's Cure is back up again, having basically lost nothing for that team fight. Boosted Bonobos knows they have to force something. They saw the rotation, and both of the teams are coming in. Sonya will be the latest. She is not here yet. Everybody has their R buttons, and here we go. There's the D-Storm. There's the Crushing Jaws. There is the Kerrigan combo. Joe does have the death save, but look at the Vikings on the backside cleaning up Phoenix, body blocking in Kerrigan, and look at that. They just a roadblock for the Boosted Bonobos, and it is an absolute bloodbath. 3 are down, 4 are down, 5 are down. The patented Lost Vikings flank.
And I think the cage might have also trapped them in there a little bit, like trapping their own team into that corner, which was not ideal. But yeah, definitely a great team fight by Nature's Cure. Big rotation. The Boosted Bonobo is already a little bit down on health and basic abilities from trying to take down that boss. It's always better to be the invading team. And Nature's Cure breaking out the Vikings and getting the game one win here on Alterac Pass.
Yeah, absolutely. I have a feeling that if we are on a Vikings...
It's okay. Just give me more time to eat my dinner, Goose. It's fine.
Well, we have sound.
Oh, of course. Now everybody knows I'm eating my dinner.
That's right. So
that's all right.
Thanks again for those of you guys hanging out. Like I said at the start, I completely revamped all of my overlays. So this cast is a little bit finding where I didn't set something up, like that screen just now. I didn't see, frankly, a lot between those teams, like skill wise, it felt very close.
Yeah,
I would really
very, very back and forth for sure.
I would really like to see a game a little more traditional. I always like seeing some Vikings, but with as close as these two teams are, with kind of a more traditional matchup, I think it would be really fun to watch these guys go at it.
Yeah, and you can tell that I feel like a lot of the differences in this game came down to the macro play and the flexibility that the Vikings gave to Nature's Cure. They were able to rotate around as 4, get the fights they wanted when they wanted them. And with the exception of a few moments where Boosted Bonobos was able to force onto Nature's Cure, it was kind of Nature's Cure's game to lose. And Boosted Bonobos just not able to really get a whole lot off of their team fight wins in those moments, because they win it right after the map objective was won by the other squad, and then they'd have to spend their time clearing the map objective before they could go try to take another fight to get another advantage.
Yeah, that's actually the exact point I was going to bring up. After every team fight win that Boosted Bonobos had, and there were plenty of them that they had throughout the course of the game.
Yeah, they had more kills.
Right. They never really had the chance to. All right, we killed 3-4 of them. Now let's go take a fort or take a boss or take a keep. It was always, all right, now let's go do damage control. Let's get back on this map and start pushing these lanes back. Right. They were always having to kind of undo what the Vikings had been doing in the meantime. All right, so waiting for our teams here. In the meantime, you know what? I'll play our little Patreon bumper. If you're not aware, NGS does have a Patreon. It lets us do all of the wonderful things that we do. So if you're so inclined to support us, we would appreciate it. Of course, it is not necessary, and NGS will always be free. But if you're so inclined, here's the info. All right, so we are back for game number 2 on Garden of Terror, another Vikings map. This time, first pick on the side of Boosted Bonobos.
And of course, Garden of Terror, the new map in the rotation this season.
Yep.
So be interested to see what these teams got going on for this, because I haven't seen a whole lot of NGS Garden of Terror in my time playing here.
I have not either. I actually like Garden of Terror. I think it's a fun map.
Yeah, it's all right.
I actually like most of the maps, honestly, with a few exceptions. So,
Braxis.
Yeah, that's one of the ones. I don't care for it too much. It's all right. But here we go. Game 2, Boosted Bonobos versus Nature's Cure. And let's watch the Vikings pick, right? Boosted Bonobos plays them as well. Will they first pick him? Will Nature's Cure ban it? We'll see. So Rexxar and Sylv, first bans, respectively, for Boosted Bonobos and Nature's Cure.
Seems familiar.
Indeed.
also seems familiar. Tychus thrown out early.
So is it going to be here?
There's the question, and we'll get it answered. Sometime in the next 19 seconds.
They're thinking about it.
Yeah. It's. I'm sure it's a debate. A team that prioritizes that hero so high is also going to wonder whether or not they want to give it to the other team. So,
you know, we'll see. Instead, they're going to ban out Chromie. So, will Again. Boosted Bonobos first pick Vikings? The answer is yes.
Absolutely.
The answer is yes.
Are we sure the teams didn't switch on us? No, I'm kidding.
You know, I mentioned it in game 1. Both these teams play them. Both these teams prioritize them highly. And both of these maps were Vikings maps, so yeah. it's not surprising.
So, of course, Garden of Terror, the map that is incredibly heavy on camps. In fact, I think it has more camps than any other map in the format.
I think you're correct.
And so the Vikings' ability to not only bribe them, but then take the Merc Queen talent to empower them in that push... really puts a lot of pressure on the other team to be able to clear. You need a ton of wave clear here anyway, but if the other team is going to have an advantage in camp taking, you need to match that with just massive wave clear.
And the flip side, speaking of Murkers, Hogger picked up from Nature's Cure. Yeah. Seeing a lot of bans lately, he's a pretty annoying hero to play against. Really good at taking camps. And Johanna to help offset some of that Viking pressure. And then we have Falstead and Anna banning out the Cho'Gall. Nature's Cure did do their homework. That is something the Bonobos like to run. And with the Anna showing there and the Tychus ban, the Cho'Gall ban makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, and you know, it's odd enough having to cast a Lost Vikings team. I don't know if I want to cast a Cho'Gall and Vikings on the same team. Just having to not only add two characters for the Vikings, also having to minus one for the Cho'Gall. I'm not sure my caster mastered brain can handle that.
So Anduin banned out by boosted Bonobos. The Johanna Anduin or Johanduin combination strong, keeping that combination off the table. Nature's Cure will pick up Jaina and the Stukov that was so impactful in game number one.
Yeah, Jaina also kind of born anew from just a small change that was made to her in that level 4 talent, where now she gets the extra percentage above a certain amount of mana, and better mana regen at that with that level 4. So loosens up the level 1 talent a little bit, where it's not always the Globe Quest, and has really powered up her Blizzard build. So it'll be interesting to see if that's the build we see Soil Water go, but see the impact as we see this new season, new Jaina, in these first couple weeks.
Cassia and Uther rounding out the comp for Bonobos. What's going to be interesting, something you don't hear talked about too much, is a resource that both teams have, which is like Health Pool, right? Health Pool is a resource. And Nature's Cure has a definite advantage in total health pool, right? No, big, burly heroes on the side for boosted Bonobos, so we'll have to see if that's a factor. And Anna and Falstad are, you know, straight squishy. They're just squishy heroes. So we'll have to see if the double support can kind of offset what might be a vulnerability in the comp. All right, Jay, we're going to play our intro, load into game number two, and see how that goes. Game number two. The boosted Bonobos trying to force out game number three and pick up at least 1 point. We have Wipeout playing Eric and Balog and Olaf. The Lost Vikings' patience is on Anna. Muffin back on tank. Uther confused, riding a Triceratops, playing Cassia, and Infafox on the very best Falstad, Buccaneer Falstad.
And on the right for Nature's Cure, we've got Soil Water on the Jaina, the J. Ruckus on the Johanna, Noel Sanaka on the Hogger, Heroes Polyphics on the Stukov, and Enigma on the Zul'jin.
Well, this is a first. I've never had two fire alarms in a game before, Jay.
I mean, this match is straight fire, yo.
Tip your waitresses.
Right?
Well, I'll be honest, I thought we would run into more hiccups than we did with the cast, so...
Well, there you go. We got the toughest part out of the way, though.
Yeah, and for those of you noticing that I have the little avatar up, my webcam literally died this morning, so there was that too. All right, we are back.
It's okay. It makes me feel a little less self-conscious. There you go.
Back in game, and here we go. So boosted Bonobos, not wanting to stack the Zul'jin, having zero interest in taking the traditional gentleman's midlane skirmish, rotate the entire squad for a bush party in the top lane. Hogger might be the one to catch it. He does eat the slow. He does eat the stun. Blizzard there from Jaina allows him to Tasmanian devil his way to safety. And now the re-engage from Nature's Cure.
Well, there's the double sleep coming out from Patience.
Yeah, That's so much of what Anna does, right? If that Anna player hits those sleep darts, her impact is so high. But if you're missing that skill shot, it's just such a big part of her pitch you're getting value out of.
Yeah. I mean, catching one is a big deal. Catching multiple is a train wreck waiting to happen for the other team.
So Wipeout made sure he had his cup of coffee before having to kill all three Vikings here. Zhukov is in the bottom lane. Now Nature's Cure, they're getting aggressive. They want to put as much pressure on the map as possible. A three-man invade here. And I don't think Roosted Bonobos has any idea. They're getting both top wave camps at the same time, Jim.
Yeah, this is a what some people might look at as a greedy play, right? You spread out, they're getting Zhukov soaking in the bottom lane, so if you get invaded anywhere, you're pretty much just gonna die when you're so spread out like that. But no punishment here from the Bonobos. They only have the four main heroes to do all of that while the Vikings are soaking. And yeah, it's a good job here by Nature's Cure. They don't really suffer much in the soaking game either. They did that at an advantageous time, so look out for them.
And not just that, they have their spell armor here, and the giants they picked up on the other side of the map are actually proccing the wave, so they don't have any of Boosted Bonobo's wave to come in and kind of offset the push. They just stepped in hard and took out the wall, and Eric as well.
Yeah, really nice macro play from the start, but you kind of expect that from the team that picked the map. They've got a plan here,
sure.
And now it's a matter of whether or not the Bonobos can kind of adjust to that, now that they've seen this initial part of the playbook here.
Well, and you had to figure, combined with how long they thought about the ban and the fact that they banned the Cho'Gall, Nature's Cure did their homework, so they had to be anticipating Vikings, right?
Right.
So a nice drive here, aggressive drive from Infobox. Now Zul'jin eating a lot of damage from Confused on the Cascade, but now she is split out. Olaf coming to the rescue. Balog goes down, but really not much else lost.
Yeah, it's going to be first seed going over to Nature's Cure. And there's another big sleep to kind of halt the advance here of the Gibricus.
Best be ready to gather another seed.
That's a quick spawn on the next seed. We're going right on to the next objective here, Goose.
Yeah, Muffin really fishing for somebody. And Fox went out a little bit. And they had a condemn race. Look at Muffin. All the way around the back. Went straight at Zul'jin. Unfortunately, the damage was a little far away. Couldn't quite get it there to follow up. 10 seconds on the tribute spawn. Not tribute, but the seed. Speed. What are the seeds? Little garden guardian guys?
That seed is ready for gathering. I suggest you do it now.
So here's level 7 ice. We got the ice fury wand here for Jaina. So now she's got the CDR coming in on that blizzard. We'll have to see if she can up the burst as she gets closer to finishing that first talent as well with the globe. Muffin taking a ton of damage. Lookout trying to walk away. He's going to go down. He'll have the ghost heals, but the zoning is good. And Zhukov able to just tap on the backside for a second seed now for Nature's Cure.
Yeah, the Hogger and Johanna were just like an offensive line. They just stood shoulder to shoulder in that little choke and did not let anybody go by. Yeah, they just stood there. Nobody could physically get by.
Yeah, it reminds me of the wall of shields and spears in Game of Thrones.
It's, absolutely.
You're not getting by this.
That was a great sleep by Patience there. May have saved and Fox from eating and condemned there, but another aggressive invade. You know, not overreacting.
Yeah, all five.
Yeah, not really overreacting to the lane presence of the Vikings.
Right, but they're keeping up in XP. It's because they're collapsing quickly. They're not spending forever fighting over these. They just quickly go in. They quickly get the steal because they've got big time camp clear damage between the Hogger and the Jaina. And then they just go back to lanes. They just get back to soaking quick so they don't lose too much in that part of the map.
And once again, they're here first. Boosted Bonobos trying to force their way in. Hogger is taking out the little seed guardians. Balog goes down. Worth noting, all the Vikings are here. They are not in lane. lane right now. So they're like really playing to get this. And with two of the seeds already secured by Nature Secure, they do not want to give up the third one. However, they will not have a choice. With the lack of big bodies I mentioned, they're really having a hard time forcing their way past Johanna.
Yeah, and I fear that problem may only get worse later in the game here, because that Jaina's damage, that burst damage is just going to continue to go up as the game goes along. And you mentioned it earlier, the lower health pools. You know, if you can burst through some of these lower health pools quickly, that's going to be a problem. But it's a big problem for Zul'jin here, as suddenly boosted Bonobos pushing back into this mid lane against the push of Nature's Cure.
And a really aggressive barrel roll, too, from Impafok to secure that kill. Then the fly down to the bottom lane, doing everything they can to save this bottom fort. I do not think that will happen. And I think Nature's Cure is... are they just going to step in mid here?
They're looking for Hogger here?
Red team has destroyed a catch the Hogger.
No, he's able to spin his way on out. They clean up bottom lane, but yeah, it looks like the... the push comes back to mid, and now level 10's in for both squads.
Yep, 10's are here. We have Storm.
Red team has destroyed it!
Nano boost, of course. There's the Divine Storm. There's the Ball Lightning. All the buttons being pressed. Ring of Frost does not can, but it will not matter. Cassia isolated out and taken down. Patience running for his life. Gust, that must have been a misclick because it was in the wrong direction, but the Sleep Dart will peel for himself, and only one lost for boosted Bonobos.
Yeah, finishing out the heroics, it's play again for the Vikings. On the other side, we got Ring of Frost, Blessed Shield, Shockwave, Flailing Swipe, and the Tazdingo!
Yeah, and Nature's Cure, Jay, they're just running this map. They are doing everything they want to do, getting any camp they want all over this map. I mean, look at the left side of the map. All of the camps
red,
were
red.
Every single one of them.
Infofox with a sneaky invade. Gotta go ahead and hit the back button. But actually, they're in position here. You know, Infofox finishes the back, and now it's kind of abandoned Muffin out here.
He's like, see ya, dude.
Once again, I'm out.
I mean, they did need to respond to the pressure bottom, right? So I get it. But once again, Falstad showing bottom means Nature's Cures knows they can step onto these giants.
Yeah, just very good map presence here all around from Nature's Cure. And if they can continue this through the rest of the game, I'm not sure how exactly boosted Bonobo's response to that. You know, the we saw last game that kills were kind of their way to stay in the match, and it just didn't last forever. I fear we may be seeing a repeat pattern.
Although they want this. Boosted Bonobos is here. They look like they're thinking about it, but in the end they won't. And Vikings has a hard time dealing with the Merc pressure, right?
Right.
So, I mean, Boosted Bonobos, they cannot force past Johanna. They're having a hard time dealing with the wave pressure. I don't think they've secured a single seed channel so far this game. I will say, though, despite all that, they're up in level, Jay.
Yeah, I mean, that's the effect of the Vikings. They've been soaking. And, you know, up to about a level 11 or 12, Nature's Cure was staying in exactly at the same level. But now they're rotating around and forcing in on these camps is costing them a little bit of soak. But, you know, as long as they stay within a level or so, I think that's fine. You know, they're going to have plenty of windows where they can force. And if they're getting all of the map objectives, they're eventually going to catch up in level anyways.
Yeah, and one of the disadvantages to all the Merc pressure that Nature's Cure is putting out there is you are pushing the experience into Vikings for them so easily.
Right, yeah.
Iron Skin goes out. Oh, that is a big time play. Cassia and Falstad absolutely wrecked. Johanna setting up the Ring of Frost, and another seed will go over to Nature's Cure.
Hero slain.
Yeah, Olaf falling just for good measure in the mid. Zul'jin taking him out. And to your point, though, Goose, not only does it make it easy for the Vikings to pick up that XP, but it makes it a little perilous for your team to step out and do that.
Yeah,
but so basically, Nature's Cure is fine with that. They're just gonna rotate around the map, do what you can do to counter these Vikings, and pick off the four man. And that's exactly what we saw them do there.
Do manage to get the double stun onto the Stukov. That was a big time play. They really needed that. Uther is really good at initiating this, but he has had such a hard time getting past the front line to land the stuns on the vulnerable target. Getting it onto the Stukov finally is huge, and they're going to get aggressive here for once themselves, but there is a party waiting for them, and Muffin is walking right into it, and Bunny gets out because he's Uther. That's like what he wants.
Right, no Divine Storm there to help him. He will fall just as that Mighty Gust comes out. But now with the Uther heals, they're trying to see if they can take advantage and get a little bit of force here before that Ghost heal falls off. And is he going to get the kill so close? No! We're going to see him charging on out of that situation. Hogger, so slippery.
Yeah, even though they did get the Uther kill, the health bars for Nature's Cure were really low. So that was actually a real smart play of Uther Bonobos. Even though Uther was down, they still had a healer, they had ghost heals. They knew they could step in despite losing their tank.
Yeah, and if you can get that stagger, you can start to turn this around a little bit. We are going to see Olaf going down to the what do you call those? The seed protectors. I know there's a better name for them, though.
That works for me. First,
the shamblers. There we go. I knew it. It was deep in those memory banks. I played this game way too long.
First seed of the game over for Boosted Bonobos. Muffin being aggressive, stepping in again. Here we go. Right into the spell armor, though. There's the silence. The gust does get Muffin out. Hogger isolated on the backside and absolutely wrecked. Jaina does catch Falstab, though, and a 1-4-1. I will say, though, trading kills, I think you're okay with that if you're Boosted Bonobos, because you got the Vikings, right?
Yeah, and also are behind in the overall map presence here, with all three forts still being alive for the side of Nature's Cure. So if you just keep it status quo, you're doing okay, but eventually they're gonna have to force here and start turning the momentum around if they're gonna hope to start chipping away at the structure advantage that Nature's Cure has.
Yeah, and the mercenaries that Nature's Cure is putting on the board combined with the spawn location basically just bought them free. What are they called? The garden terrors,
yeah. They are kind of horrific, though, aren't they?
Yeah. So second objective push here for Nature's Cure, and if you're Boosted Bonobos, you are going to be super happy if all of your teams are up after this. That's kind of your goal.
That's lofty. Yeah, that's exactly. A lofty goal, my friend.
But honestly, even if they only lose one, I think you're kind of okay.
Yeah, absolutely. We're going to see them pushing into mid here. Good defense overall, though, so far. It's really preventing Nature's Cure from pushing in deep. Olaf going to get stunned, though, by the boss. He's going to be able to back up. That's a very healthy keep still. We are going to see the swipe following up that Divine Shield. Only Uther caught in the ring, though. The Gust from Infobox going to try to disengage, but they get the Joe on the backside of this goose.
Yeah, I think what happened there is, and I would assume that he waited for it. He gusted when Joe had her iron skin out, so she didn't go anywhere. Yeah, and that's a real clever play by him.
Yeah, I mean, the classic is just to try to flank around and gust everyone, but you can just gust right through if that iron skin is up. Very, I hadn't really thought of that as a Joe counter, but makes a lot of sense now.
And you'll notice all of the keeps are up. Uh-oh. Mr. Jason. Here comes Falstad. He's looking for somebody. They are.
Yeah, you see the danger pings coming out as they are running for their lives right now as Nature's Cure. Muffin goes in, gets a double stun there off the Benediction, but not going to be able to really set up a true end gauge. It'll give Infofox enough room to go ahead and bribe the camp, but now they're going to start backing up. They want to try to force here before 20 if they can. Both teams pretty even right now, so we'll see if they can find something a little more juicy.
Yeah, that particular choke with the Stukov under towers would have been a real rough place to try to force that. And they have all three of their keeps are fairly low with Katas pushing in, so I think they kind of figured, you know what, it's not here. We made a run at it, and I think it was the right call, right? Let's see if we can catch him without Joe. But they didn't, and then they back up and do a little damage control.
Right. And now they're going to try to get some of their own camps out here before they can be stolen. But look at the rotation in the bottom here. Nature's here kind of rotate down, look to take out Baylog if they can, but if not, gonna turn around onto this keep and then see if they can secure one. The question is, will they be able to get out of here?
There is Gust up. Divine Storm runs right in. It does catch two. There is the ring, catches Baylog and Cassia, though she is still alive. Falstad, though, gets rolled over by Augur. And that is one and a third unanswered for Nature's Cure. It was a good hard rotation for boosted Bonobos. They just couldn't quite get to where they wanted to be.
Yeah, also just not quite in sync on that rotation either. I think Uther a little bit too far ahead. Again, the damage not quite able to follow up the way they wanted. But again, the Stukov swipes have been pretty key. Yeah, between the big lurking arms and the swipes in both of these games, it's been really a support showing here for Nature's Cure.
Yeah, Eurosplix on the Stukov has been really, really solid. Very impactful on both games.
Level 20 is now coming out for both squads. Pretty much what I would expect on both sides. Deep Chill gonna give some extra slow for the Jaina. Indestructible, of course, coming out. Top Off gonna be interesting to try and keep everybody nice and healthy here. And that healing that you can get back from Amani Resilience gonna be kind of tough to play into.
Muffin insta-presses the D-Storm, kind of knowing that he was caught in the middle of everybody. But fortunately, not much there for boosted Bonobos. And even though the levels are equal, the map control is just so heavily in favor of Nature's Cure.
Yeah, I'm not really sure what that play was meant to be for the Bonobos. You know, if you're gonna check that bush, they're going to be willing to spend your big upgraded Divine Storm, especially if you don't have Redemption. Your team's got to be ready to follow that up, so it's just unfortunate they couldn't make anything out of that, and I think you might be looking at the beginning of the end.
I don't think they're going to go in post 20. Is that a kill? Now, the Nature's Cure, if they get a kill, then they end, so there the Fall Tech goes down, all the numbers are down, Anna goes down, I think that will.
Yeah, the siege damage, you're right, the siege damage. Well, it's actually pretty good between the Zul'jin and the Jaina. So yeah, this is definitely the end. They are going to try to mount the defense here, though, for the Bonobos. Baylog falls, D-Storm comes out to try and slow him down a little bit, but now the core is falling, just 16% left. All they got to do is just turn and right-click on that core, and just like that, Nature's Cure with a 2-0 sweep, finishing it off here on Garden of Terror.
Yeah, I kind of pointed out at the draft I was concerned about the body lightness of what boosted Bonobos had, and through the course of that game they just could not force past the front line. They couldn't get the damage onto the vulnerable heroes where it was needed. Uther just kind of didn't have the tools to get past to the Joe and the Hogger. You know, as well as Muffin, you know, played him. It's just that he doesn't have that tool set to do what they were trying to do.
Right. Yeah, 13-5 kind of spells out a lot of how this game went. There were a couple of moments where you might, you know, might call them flashes of brilliance coming in for the Bonobos, but ultimately just a pretty well controlled match. Nature's Cure, you might call them the masters of the Lost Vikings here today, being able to win with it and against it.
Yeah, and they really showed that game too. You know, how important it is not to overreact to the Vikings' constant pressure, right? They weren't concerned about being in every lane all the time. They were aggressive on the invades. They made it so the Vikings were constantly having to deal with mercenaries marching down every lane. They moved quickly. They moved decisively. They picked up the soak as a group and just moved on to the next place they needed to be. Really clean game.
Yeah, you can't have everything, Goose. You know, you want to be able to soak all of these lanes against the Vikings, but if you're playing to that end against them, you're giving up one of your biggest advantages against the Vikings, which is that there's only four members of the rest of the team. Mm-hmm. If you take that 5v4, you can force anywhere on the map.
Absolutely.
And you have to force the Vikings to give up their soak advantage to come answer to you.
Absolutely.
You got to play on your terms, not on the Vikings' terms.
And then it was compounded by the fact that the heroes that made up the rest of the comp for boosted bonobos just couldn't force in. Like they could never force in. I think boosted bonobos only picked up one seed the whole game. Is my memory correct?
That sounds right. Yeah, they got one in the top left, but I think that was the only one they got.
All right.
Which, you know, with the Vikings, you kind of expect to have a little bit better ability to do that because you can always have a Vikings present to grab it. But again, it's just macro for Nature's Cure. They were just always in position to contest those, except for one throughout the whole time.
Let's see if we can get one of the someones from Nature's Cure for a quick chat before we wrap it up. You want to jump into, let's see, voice channel NGS lobby one?
Sounds good to me.
All right. Well, Jay, I think I'm going to call the cast a moderate success. Hey, how are you?
I just jumped in here. I was looking for the reply, but...
It's all good.
Well, there you go.
Jump in away. Joining us is Sailwater, Jaina player.
Mm-hmm.
Was that both games you were on Jaina? Is that right? Or
no? First game I was on Zul'jin.
Zul'jin, that's right. All right.
Yeah, a couple of Zul'jin players on your squad.
I think three of us can play Zul'jin.
Well, now I want to see that. I want to see a three Zul'jin game. Well, congratulations on the 2-0, picking up the domination and 3 points. And I believe, that's your second domination of the season, right? You guys managed to pick up a win against Lurk Patrol, so looking good so far. How are you guys feeling after the game? What was the chatter like in comms afterward?
Just happy. just happy, and we all were mentioning that we did well.
Sure. Let's talk about Vikings. We're obviously a huge part of the set. And not surprising, because both teams play Vikings, and they're pretty strong. Talk about your guys' approach in game two. I know a lot of teams struggle into Vikings, and they're more common than they used to be, but not every team has Vikings players, so sometimes it can get hard to practice against Vikings. Talk about your approach on how to deal with the Vikings' presence in that game too, because you guys were all over the map and just constant pressure. So maybe talk about your approach in that game, if you don't mind.
So the big thing with that was just being aware of where their technical four-man should be running around, and then looking for picks, and then kind of using one person to soak away. So we used Hogger for most of it to soak an offlane technically, and then we ran back and forth and double soaked and then picked up camps along the way. So just denying them the chance to push up, since it's really hard to play as a Vikings player if the map is getting turned all of the opposite color.
Yes, yeah, and that was noticeable in that game too. The wipeout on the Vikings was, you know, goaltending a lot. It's hard for them to clear out the mercenaries. You know, they just don't have, you know, the tools to really clear lanes that way. So, are you guys, I believe, a new team this season, or at least this group is a new team. Is that correct?
New team in NGS and new team altogether.
All right. Well, maybe talk about yourself a little bit.
Well, we all played together quite a bit. I've known like Enigma for a couple of years. Didn't play with him as much. And then invited him to come play on our team. And then JR and Nolsonaka, I've clocked probably over With Noel Slanaka, I know I've played over 3,000 games with him, and then JR, I'm probably over the 1,000 mark of games played with him as well. And then Heroes Flix is, I've played some with, I've played against him a lot, and he fits in nicely with the crew we have.
Jason, any questions from you, sir?
So we saw in that game number 2 draft, the ban on Cho'Gall. I just wanted to ask you a little bit about your thought process on banning Cho'Gall, and if you think that would have changed the scope of the game, or like how much you think it would have changed it for game number 2.
You know, Cho'Gall in the right hands is kind of scary, and if you have a 4v4 with Cho'Gall, or even the sieging potential, and I don't know if, like, if they would expect, like, orb build that stuns people, so stuns on top of Uther stuns on top of Anna sleeps, and then massive gall damage with all of that, that just doesn't sound like a good time. So, and they banned Tychus on the first round of bans.
Right.
Like, immediately. Instead of trying to target ban. They target banned Rexxar, and they banned Tychus, so I just was kind of like, you know, the worst possible thing they could do is use Cho'Gall with their 4 stack, which I have a feeling they were probably setting up for.
Yeah, I mean, that they already drafted the Anna, they had banned Tychus, so you could kind of maybe smell that is a possibility. I mentioned in the draft, I really like that ban, kind of for those reasons, so. Anything else from you, Mr. Jason?
No, I think that pretty much covers it. I was really impressed with how you guys played tonight, and I'm looking forward to seeing how you guys do the rest of the season.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Also, thanks for having us, or thanks for casting us. It's always great.
Well, thanks for tolerating the slight technical snafus when you guys watch it. I completely redid my overlay setup. So I was 100% positive I would run into little things here and there I missed, and I did. But overall, I actually went pretty good. Either way, welcome to NGS. Happy to have you guys. And any shout-outs before we let you go celebrate with your team?
Well, shout-out to the other team. Thanks for playing against us. It was fun. And thanks to you guys. And then just shout-out to my team in general for playing really well.
All right, well,
worked as a team.
Yeah, you did.
Thank you.
Especially that game 1 was a brutal back and forth. We didn't even really touch on it much. We probably should have. But game 1 was... Actually, let's do it before we let you go. Game 1,
super-duper
back and forth. I mean, you guys were just murdering each other both ways. What was the feeling like kind of during the game as you were kind of going on that roller coaster? What was that like?
A little nerve-wracking for a couple moments, but everyone, like, if we made a mistake, it's okay. We still have control of what we're doing, and we just had to play smart to make up for those little errors. So playing smart, just, like, not getting wiped. When the opposing team had the map objective, and they were sieging our top keep, if they would have wiped us there, that probably would have been game for us. So just making sure we stayed alive in very crucial times. And that's more or less what it comes down to.
I was surprised in that game 1 how just aggressive and kind of rolling over their comp was. It was kind of like a snowball. They just kept going. Did that kind of catch you off guard, how just kind of aggro that comp was initially?
A little bit. Like, they definitely ran at us throughout the entirety of the game. Like, if they figured we were in an area, they were coming at us, so we were talking, like, make sure we don't run that way, and they still got us a few times, and the Lucio speed ups to get us unmounted to continue their engage was kind of mean. Other than that,
And last question before I let you go. Jay and I both noticed and highlighted during the game, Heroesplifix, am I saying that right? Heroesplifix? Mm-hmm. On
Heroesplifix?
Yeah.
Yes.
Had some plays really showing off. Talk about your support and the Stukov play of the set.
Well, he has a few supports that he plays. He's originally a ranged player, and then he's like, hey guys, I'll play support for you. So he's been practicing playing support units, and Stukov is definitely one of his favorites. I've seen him do some really cool stuff. Like, he goes and does the root thing with the Weight of Pustule, and I've tried playing Stukov a bunch, and I never seem to be able to get it. And he does it consistently, so.
Yeah, some really, really big lurking arms. Big playmaking potential out of Stukov. We saw it a couple times those games.
So, I'm happy he's doing it. I wouldn't want to be on the receiving end of it.
All right, well, I think that's actually, this time we'll actually end the interview. it would have been a crime to ignore that game one, which was so good, so.
Fair enough.
All right, well, have a good night, and hopefully we'll catch you guys in the near future. Good luck the rest of the season.
Yes, thanks to you. Thank you, and same to you guys.
Well, thanks.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, Jay. I will sign myself off first so you can call us out because you got stuff going on tonight. I'm going to try to cast more this season as the newborn will allow. It's a little rough for me to find the time to do it, but we're going to try. And playing on Regen Ghost and Jay on Divine, if you guys want to support us, you can find those games. And that's pretty much it for me. Jay, what do you got going tonight?
Well, I've got episode number 7 of my Stardew Valley playthrough. Going to be going live just as soon as I log out of here. So I'm going to actually say thanks for having me, Mongoose. It's always a pleasure. I look forward to seeing you, if not earlier, Saturday night when we play D&D.
Absolutely.
But yeah, I'll be over at Jason Hotz here on Twitch. And I actually have a big announcement coming up here at 10 o'clock. So if you guys want to, you can come over, hang out for a little while, watch me play this Stardew Valley playthrough continued. I think I'm probably finishing the community center and maybe taking our first steps onto Ginger Island tonight. So that should be fun. I'll probably go for about 4 to 5 hours before I'll pass out and not just in the game, but out of the game as well. So, big announcement coming at 10 of something that might be interesting to some people. We'll see how much support I get for it. But that'll be coming in about 40 minutes or so.
All right. Well, have fun with that. 4 hours of Stardew Valley, you animal.
After 8 hours of work and an hour or so of cast. Yeah, busy day here.
Well, thanks for hanging out with us, those of you who are still here. Hope you enjoyed the game, and don't hesitate to hang out and support Jay's stream. Have a great night.